Hey, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming out this morning. Good to see everybody. Got a lot of things to talk about. Hope you got a bulletin, got a pen. Some things are not in the bulletin, so you may want to just scratch some things down, which is always a lot of good. Hey, we're glad to have Wendy Carter. Thank you for coming this morning. Appreciate that. Jeremy and Nicole's friend. Appreciate that. And Michael Smith. Thank you for coming this morning. Okay. Mark and Sheila's friend. Mark, y'all known each other for 20, 30 years probably? Oh, 10 or 15. Good deal. So glad to have you, Michael. I appreciate that very much. Hey, a couple things going on. We'll start with immediate things right after church. How about that? Tammy, who is in the nursery, is interested in having a ladies' tea sometime in May. And Lucy, do you know, you kind of know a little bit about this. Maybe you... tonight there will be a the Adorn Bible study for the ladies Bible study. The guys had theirs on Friday night. The girls are going to be out. The ladies are going to be out tonight at 5 o'clock. And I'm looking in here, and it says that the subject is an unexpected blessing. Okay, discovering the strength and beauty of submission. Fantastic. Y'all will have a great time at 5 o'clock tonight. That'll be really good. And then on Monday night, there's going to be a board meeting on Monday night. Anything? Okay. All the board member knows what's going on, and so that's good. Board meeting on Monday night. And then on Wednesday night, we got a Bible study over here. Jeremy's going to be teaching the Bible study over here Wednesday night. And then also CBC is going on. CBC is a great time. I hope everybody comes and bring your kids. And if you have any questions about it, come see me. Come talk to me about it. I'd love to talk to you about CBC. Oh, Aunt Cindy's teaching. Okay, good. Cindy, you're teaching Wednesday night. All right, I love it. Thank you. Esther, wow, what a good one. Good. Thank you. All right, Thursday night is going to be Ranch. Ranch and the young adult are going to be kind of combined this week, which we haven't done that in a long, long time. Usually Ranch is in the old building over there, the white building, and then the young adults meet in the fellowship hall. But this week, for just 1 week, they're going to be combined together, and Jeremy's going to share on there too. Jeremy, we're putting you to work this week, man. I know. The pay is horrible too, okay? But... out of this world. There you go. We appreciate it very much. That's going to be really, really good. A couple other things you can see that I'm just moving down the list is that the teenagers are going to have a movie night. And that's going to be a lot of fun. That's going to be on, we're going to have it on Good Friday. It's going to be on Good Friday night. They're going to watch God's Not Dead. part one. I think they're kind of fitting for Resurrection Sunday coming up. Okay, really fitting. I like that. So thank you so much for Abigail suggested that. I guess you did. Okay, that was good. Good. That fits perfect. So y'all are welcome to do that. We're going to be over in the ranch room on that Friday night. That's always good. And then and then very next day on Saturday, which is coming up on March 30th, we're going to have a resurrection egg hunt. And so that's always a lot of fun. You can read about that. Bring some filled candy-filled eggs. And Lucy, tell us about some special thing we're going to do too. That's good. That'll be a lot of fun. Keep looking at that. Speaking of Southern Grace Youth Camp, our speaker, the senior speaker this year for Southern Grace Youth Camp, is going to be a guy by the name of Mark Paskiewicz. He's out of New York. You know, got this Yankee that's kind of come down and going to speak. But it's going to be good. He came to our youth retreat back in November, and everybody liked him. And he, good guy. So I'm really glad he's coming, Mark Paskiewicz. And then Glenn Bocamp, who is pastor of Greystone Bible Church, he is going to be the junior camp speaker. So man, we got a good lineup this year. Really, really good. So excited about that. So that's at the very bottom down there. It's the 10th through the 14th. Camp's going to be a little bit different this year. It's going to be a Monday through Friday this year instead of Sunday through Thursday, Monday through Friday. So I'm excited about that. And Anna, did you put this little thing at the bottom down here? Is that you? Okay. Tell us one more time about this little dark spot down here. Okay. Okay. Does it cost to get in, or it's all free? Okay, got it. Better than some of the other things that are on TV. This is good. I'm glad for that. All right. Any other announcements? Did I forget anything? All right. Thank you very much. Yeah. Appreciate it. Thank you.
right. And Anna and I have a special for you today. So we're going to sing a song.
It's weird. Y'all see me every Sunday. Thanks, Harley. That's a vote of confidence.
Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the
come forward for the offering. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day that we can come and worship you and learn about you. We pray for our pastor, for Jeremy as he comes up here and speaks today, that you'll speak through him and that we'll learn something that we've forgotten, something new, but we're excited that he's going to come up here and speak. We want to pray for our offering that will be used of you. In your name, amen.
All right, let's stand and continue worshiping.
Come through the
be seated.
And the children are dismissed for children's church.
Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you all for singing this morning.
Yeah, amen.
Good. And surely enjoyed that. All right, Jeremy's going to speak this morning. I'm excited about that. Donna and I are going to go out of town this afternoon. And so I asked Jeremy if he would speak, and Jeremy's like, he's ready. Let's do it, you know? And you never see Jeremy with a discouraging face. Have y'all ever noticed that? I mean, I don't know. He's always just Amen. Got the joy of the Lord, and I really appreciate him a lot this morning. The subject's going to be?
Who can God graft in?
Wow, that'll be interesting.
Yeah.
Jeremy's always got these things. I don't know where he comes up with this stuff, but he comes up with it. I'm excited.
The Holy Ghost.
There you go. Holy Spirit works in his life. I appreciate that. I appreciate you speaking this morning and cheering with us. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, thank you this morning for Jeremy. Thank you, Lord, for his desire to want to share the word of God. Lord, I thank you that you placed in his heart a mission, Lord, and a ministry to get the word out to as many people as possible. Lord, I thank you for his life. Thank you for his family, and thank you for his good testimony. And Lord, I just pray for him as he shares, and the Holy Spirit and will just work in our lives. In your name, amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you.
Who can God graft in? We're Matthew chapter 1. I have been looking forward to this one. Matthew chapter 1, we're going to start in verse 1 and we'll read to verse 16. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren, and Judas begat Perez and Zerah of Tamar, and Perez begat Ezram, and Ezram begat Aram, and Aram begat Amminadab, and Amminadab begat Nahson, and Nahson begat Salmon, and Salmon begat Booz of Rechab, and Booz begat Obed of Ruth, and Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon of her that had been the wife of Urias. And Solomon begat Rehoboam, and Rehoboam begat Abia, and Abia begat Asa, and Asa begat Josaphat, and Josaphat begat Joram, and Joram begat Ozias, and Ozias begat Joatham, and Joatham begat Achaz, and Achaz begat Ezekias, and Ezekias begat Manasseh, and Manasseh begat Amon, and Amon begat Josias, and Josias begat Jeconias and his brethren about the time they were carried away to Babylon. And after that they were brought to Babylon, Jeconias begat Salathiel, and Salathiel begat Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel begat Abiud, and Abiud begat Eliakim, and Eliakim begat Azor, and Azor begat Sadak, and Sadak begat Achim, and Achim begat Eliad, and Eliad begat Eleazar, and Eleazar begat Mathan, and Mathan begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. So we read through these genealogies, and you know, names are always difficult. I enjoy it as a challenge personally. But I think we forget really that these were real people that had lives, that they're just like us in many, many ways. First thing I'd like to point out is in verse 1, the book of the generation. It's singular. So you don't have to turn there, but Genesis 5, verse 1, this is the book of the generations of Adam. Same thing in Genesis 6, verse 9. These are the generations of Noah. There's a difference. So let that marinate for a little bit, and we'll come back to that. So the focus of this are the ofs. There's there's women that are mentioned in this genealogy that are very, very, very interesting. Matthew 1, verse 3, and Judas begat Phares and Zerah of Thamar. And if you've read Genesis 38, it's this weird, I say weird, but it's this thing that just kind of comes out of left field. So here's this is the genealogy. I'd put it just so you could see it at a glance. And it's pretty straightforward. There's 14 generations or 13 generations between each one. But Tamar is like the Jerry Springer show. You have this really, like, we'll go to Genesis 38. And I'm gonna step through this kind of carefully, because there's some details that I don't want to draw out for young ears right now. But it strikes me at how real this is, because this is stuff we see online. This is stuff we see in person. These people had real lives, that all these crazy things happen, and she is in the genealogy of Jesus, of the Messiah. It's amazing. So who can God graph in is the theme of this. So Genesis 38. I'm in Exodus. Wrong book. Okay, Genesis 38, we'll do verse 6. And Judah took a wife for his firstborn, whose name was Tamar. And Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord slew him. So she's married initially to Judah's older son. He dies. He's a wicked man. God kills him. And so commandment in the law of Moses is for the brother to raise up children, which goes horribly, horribly wrong. And God kills that guy as well in Onan. So it's Deuteronomy 25 verses 5 to 10 that details what a brother is supposed to do for his brother if something happens. And it's mentioned multiple times throughout. Verse 11, then said Judah to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow at thy father's house till Shelah, my son, be grown. For he said, lest peradventure he die also, as his brethren did. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. And in process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died. And Judah was comforted and went up to his sheep shearers to Timnath, he and his friend Hira the Adullamite. And it was told Tamar, saying, behold, thy father-in-law goeth up to Timnath to shear his sheep. And she put her widow's garments off from her, and covered her with a veil, and wrapped herself, and sat in an open place, which is by the way to Timnath, for she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given unto him to wife. So Judah does her dirty, quite frankly. She should have been able to raise, you know, the last son, to raise up children as well. And the thing to really keep in mind is she's not a Jew. She's not an Israelite. She's a Canaanite. Let's see, verse 26. And Judah acknowledged them, the signet, the bracelets, and staff, and said, she hath been more righteous than I, because that I gave her not to Shelah my son, and he knew her again no more. So she's going to have twins. She's going to have twins by her father-in-law, which is, again, like, we have these real deal situations that occur. You know, we want to pass blame and pretend to be righteous, but that's the thing. He says she is more righteous than I. There's a interesting thread that goes through all of these. So let's see, verse 28, 27. And it came to pass in the time of her travail that there were twins in her womb. And it came to pass when she travailed that one put out his hand, and the midwife took and bound upon his hand a scarlet thread. This came out first. And it came to pass, as he drew back his hand, that behold, his brother came out. And she said, how hast thou broken forth? This breach be upon thee. Therefore his name was called Phares. And Phares is He's a descendant, he's in the lineage of Jesus. And afterward came out his brother that had the scarlet thread upon his hand, and his name was called Zerah. So these are the sons of Israel. It doesn't say Jacob, it says Israel. So he's gotten his life right with God, and he's influencing this family. So there's, God's clearly working behind the scenes. Who can God graft in? A mess. He can graft it in. And then she gets a blessing as well in Ruth. We'll be coming back to Ruth too. Ruth chapter 4, verse 11. And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, "We are witnesses. The Lord make the woman that is come into thine house like Rachel and like Leah, which two did build the house of Israel, and do thou worthily in Ephratah, and be famous in Bethlehem, and let thy house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bare unto Judah, of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman." It's always about the holy seed. It's always all throughout. And God preserves it. It's amazing. It's pure seed. And it's interesting that the name Tamar means palm tree. We'll go back to Matthew chapter 1. You can keep your place in Matthew because we'll be back multiple times. Verse 5. And Salmon beget Booz of Rechab. That's in Joshua chapter 2. The story of Jericho and the spies that come into that Israel sent to come into the city, they're going to take it. This whole thing is just fascinating. So it's chapter 2 of the book of Joshua, verse 9. We'll start in verse 8. Well, we'll just grab verse 4 so we can get the context here. And the woman, Rahab, and the woman took the two men and hid them. So she hid them. She hid them on the roof underneath the flax. So it's fascinating too, because the roofs of these houses are always flat, and they would lay the flax on the roof to dry out. So this is nothing out of the ordinary, and it's the perfect place to hide the spies. And the woman took the two men, verse 4 of Joshua 2, and hid them, and said thus, "There came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were." Drop down to verse 8. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. And she said unto the men, "I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us. And that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you, when ye came out of Egypt, and what ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath." This thing went viral. It was the parting of the Red Sea. You really think about it. You have this army, these Jews that were led supernaturally out of the land of Egypt. They're rescued by God. So the sea parts. There's just all this crazy stuff going on in the wilderness, and the whole land of Canaan knows what's up. Like, it's clear to them, and they're scared out of their minds. It made me think, like, as adults, like September 11th, we all remember where we were at and what we were doing. You guys, William and Donna, were there, like, what, the day before, 2 days before? We were in our front room, just watching TV with our parents, and all of a sudden it's on the news. So it's this just overwhelming fear that they that people from Jericho had, that there's a God that's powerful. So it's a interesting contrast. That's just kind of like how I would picture it now. But it was absolutely clear that God was going to destroy Jericho, which is the city of palm trees. We find this again. She believed the testimony. She believed what she heard. And it's kind of, I got to thinking about that too. Salmon, who she ends up marrying, might have been one of those two spies. So there's more to behind the scenes than what it appears. Joshua chapter 6. Verse 20. So the people shouted when the priests blew with the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the shout of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight up before him, and they took the city, and they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep, and ass, with the edge of the sword. But Joshua had said unto the two men that had spied out the country, go into the harlot's house, and bring out thence the woman and all that she hath, as ye swear unto her. And the young men that were spies went in, and brought out Rahab, and her father, and her mother, and her brethren, and all that she had, and they brought out all her kindred, and left them without the camp of Israel. And then verse 25, and Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive, and her father's household, and all that she had, and she dwelleth in Israel even unto this day, because she hid the messengers which Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. Too far. Where's my other picture? There's a picture of like the walls of Jericho falling down is what it's supposed to be. So it was kind of, they were hid in her house. And if you read it, her house is like on the wall. So this is the weirdest military campaign ever. They go around silently for 6 days, just one loop around the city, and then they go off to their camp. And these guys probably making fun of them, probably, you know. The seventh day, they go around six times, and on the seventh time, they shout and the walls fall down. So how is her house still intact? You have two possibilities, and I either one would work just fine. Either that section of the wall stood standing, or she's like, her house is still floating up in the air. You know what I mean? Like, either way, it was a miracle. It was absolutely amazing. And likely, this is really what I got to thinking too, she still has a relationship with her family. The king of Jericho knew who she was. So she probably she didn't choose that lifestyle on her own. She was probably forced into it. So who can God graft in? People that have been like the Sound of Freedom, like trafficking kind of stuff. God can rescue them and graft them in. That thing makes me angry. I gotta get on. And then, Hebrews 11, she's mentioned in the Hall of Faith. She's mentioned in the Hall of Faith, and she's an Amorite. She's an Amorite. Gosh, what, like, to be who she was, and then to be, like, commemorated in the Hall of Faith with the heroes of the faith. Verse 31 of Hebrews 11. My faith, the harlot Rahab, perished not with them that believed not. And that's the key. Do you believe God or not? When she had received the spies with peace. Because of faith. It's always because of faith. Do you believe what God says? And guess what she had hanging from her window? That scarlet thread. That's the second time we see the scarlet thread. Back to Matthew 1. Gosh, I hope this like excites you as much as I do, because these are real people like entering into what they experienced. We see it on a daily basis. That's why it's, the mercy of God is so precious. And same verse, Matthew 1, verse 5. And Booz begat Obed of Ruth. Ruth is absolutely fascinating. She's got a whole book dedicated. Ruth chapter 1. Verse 22. Of course, Naomi, you know, that the story is that Naomi and her husband and her two boys go off into the land of Moab, and things don't go well. The husband dies, Naomi's husband dies, the husbands of the two wives also die, and it's just Naomi and Ruth left because the other one heads back. She goes back to her God. She's a Moabite. So Naomi returned. This is verse 22 of Ruth 1. So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess. She's industrious. And verse 11 of Ruth chapter 3. This is Boaz talking. And now, my daughter, fear not, I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. Proverbs 31. She is kind of an exception to the rule, but she's from the other side of the tracks. She's from, we don't associate with those people because they're dirty. They ain't wearing a five-piece suit. They ain't got a six-figure income. They're not driving a brand new car. List goes on, et cetera, et cetera. Let's see. And she's virtuous. Ruth 2, verse 11. And Boaz answered and said unto her, it hath fully been showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knewest not heretofore. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. Who can be grafted in? Anyone that trusts God, anyone that trusts in Jesus, in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a very interesting detail that I noticed in verse 14. And Boaz said unto her, at mealtime come thou hither and eat of the bread and dip thy morsel in the vinegar. Kind of made me think a little bit about the Last Supper. Like there's all these threads running through over and over and over. And then Ruth 3, 8 to 11. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And he said, blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast showed more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, inasmuch as thou followest not young men, whether poor or rich. She wasn't a gold digger. She was doing what's right. And now, my daughter, fear not, I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. She boldly asked him for exactly what she wanted as well. And he granted it. It's interesting that in verse 9, spread therefore thy skirt over thy handmaid, directly cross-references to Ezekiel 16, verse 8. God spreading his skirt over Israel and taking them for his own. He grafted Israel in as well, originally. And that's what's really, really fascinating about Booz, is that he's the kinsman redeemer. Redeems, Ruth 4. Each one of these could be its own in and of itself. Ruth 4, verses, 4 to 6. And this is Boaz speaking again. And I thought to advertise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me, that I may know, for there is none to redeem it beside thee, and I am after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. Then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. We see this again, raising up children. And the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Verse 10, moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate of his place. Ye are witnesses this day. Verse 12, and we read it again. And let thy house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bare unto Judah, of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. I got to thinking about it too. Where's the scarlet thread in this one? Turn to Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, verse 13. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. Drop down to verse 19. She layeth her hands to the spindle and her hands hold the distaff. Verse 21. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes it. She makes the thread. She spins it and then makes their clothes too. So we find the scarlet thread again. There's also another connection to palm trees. That verse, it's Psalm 92, verse 12. The righteous shall flourish as palm trees. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Okay, back to Matthew chapter 1. There she is in the field with Boaz. It's Ruth. David. And Jesse begat, verse 6 of Matthew 1. And Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon of her that had been the wife of Urias. That's in 2 Samuel 11. Verses 1 to 3. And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. That was the first problem. He should have been leading his men. And it came to pass in an evening tide, that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? She, if you really, really look at this, she is actually taking one of the purification baths. It's the ritual bath, according to Leviticus 15, 19 to 30 for women. And she was married to an Hittite. So again, we have It's interesting that she isn't mentioned specifically by name, but God makes sure to mention that her husband was the Hittite. So again, somebody outside the flock of God, who can God graph in? And he takes her. He takes her, and it's just, it goes super down. It's another, you know, another episode of Jerry Springer. It goes instantly off a cliff. People are dying. He ends up, he sets Uriah, which is one of his, Uriah is specifically mentioned in 2 Samuel 23:39 as one of David's mighty men. He was like one of his top fighters, one of his top warriors, and he sends him to his death so he can take his wife. 2 Samuel 12. And this, of course, is where God is calling him out to his face for his sin. We'll start in verse 4. We'll start in verse 1. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take one of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity. And Nathan said to David, thou art the man. He condemns himself. He knows that he's worthy of death. He knows that she's worthy of death. And fourfold restoration. So how many kids did David lose? He ended up losing four sons. That's that fourfold restoration. God is not mocked. We reap what we sow. But he spared David, he spared Bathsheba, and grafted them into the lineage of Jesus. What about the scarlet thread? This is Solomon. Who's the Song of Solomon, chapter 7. The first time, that's interesting. The second time, possibly a coincidence. When you see it the third time, that's no longer just by chance. Song of Solomon. Chapter 7. This is the stuff we see on crime TV, and but it's real. Again, it's real. That's really, people read the Bible and they're like, that's just a book, but it's more real and connects with us than we could ever think. It's chapter 4. Chapter 4, verses 1 to 3. Behold, thou art fair, my love. Behold, thou art fair. Thou hast dove's eyes within thy locks. Thy hair is as a flock of goats that appear from Mount Gilead. Thy teeth are like the flock of sheep that are even shorn, which came up from the washing, whereof everyone bear twins. That's interesting. Twins again. And none is barren among them. Thy lips are like a thread of scarlet, and thy speech is comely. Thy temples are like a piece of a pomegranate within thy locks. We find it over and over and over. It's just fascinating. And Song of Solomon 7 is where the palm tree is. Song of Solomon 7, verse 8. I said, I will go up to the palm tree. I will take hold of the boughs thereof. And also thy breast shall be as clusters of the vine, and the smell of thy nose like apples. It's such a beautiful picture of God's forgiveness and grafting in. I mean, murderers, adulterers, you know, people from the wrong side of the tracks. It's over and over and over again how merciful God is. So we have these, back to Matthew chapter 1. So you notice something kind of very odd here as you're reading verses 8 and 9. If you've read through the Old Testament, like 2 Chronicles, that's when it really comes out. Verse 8 and 9. And Asa begat Josaphat, and Josaphat begat Joram, and Joram begat Ozias, and Ozias begat Jotham, and Jotham begat Achaz, and Achaz begat Ezekias. There's three kings that are missing here. Turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 3. Verses 10 to 11. And Solomon's son was Rehoboam, Abia his son, Asa his son, Jehoshaphat his son, Joram his son, and then these are the three that are missing, Ahaziah his son, Joash his son, and Amaziah his son. Why are they missing? So we have this very interesting thing in 1 Kings chapter 3 that really kind of, I was kind of surprised. I call it reading it again for the first time, just kind of stumbling on stuff while I'm studying, because why does God do things the way that he does? And Solomon made affinity, and that word only appears three times in the Bible. And Solomon made affinity with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and took Pharaoh's daughter. So he marries Pharaoh's daughter. He's marrying outside, directly against the commandments of God. So it appears also in 2 Chronicles 18. Now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance and joined affinity with Ahab, this wicked king that's leading it specifically. Spoken about in Ezra 9. We'll draw it all together. I promise. I promise. Those are all three references. 9:14 is the other affinity, but it's verse 1. Now, when these things were done, the princes came to me, saying, "The people of Israel and the priests and the Levites have not separated themselves from the people of the lands, doing according to their abominations." And then we find all these people listed here, even of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites. These are the people that God's grafting in. These are the people that are, you know, so when God isn't doing it and man decides to do it on his own, God doesn't even recognize them. They're not listed in the genealogy because they were making their own affinities instead of doing what God wanted them to do. God replaces these three kings with these women. It's fascinating. It's people step over it without really, really thinking about it. Affinity, marrying somebody like us being unequally yoked. It's in 2 Corinthians. It's these commands over and over and over. So back to Matthew 1. That's a whole sordid mess. If you read through, oh my gosh, it's, you know, Athaliah is Ahab's sister, and that's who Jehoshaphat marries and has these kids that are, they're mixed. They're mixed seed. And that's the devil intentionally trying to corrupt the seed line. Verse 16. And Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. So just go to verse 18 in the same chapter. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Again, we have this weird, I say weird, we have this whole story. She's apparently pregnant before they've come together, and so immediately they're outcasts. They should be stoned. She, you know, she's an adulterer. This is a whole mess. And he was a good man. He was going to not even endure, like, publicly, not embarrass her, not make her look bad. And of course, God, you know, comes to the rescue. But it's fascinating because he willingly married her anyway. He took scorn. He took shame. Thank you. Amen. Thank you. He willingly took that shame for his wife because it was of God. And that's when the wise men show up. This is what we had discussed for Christmas, the wise men showing up. And they bring all these gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And that's probably how, because, you know, they were outcasts, just like we'd already been talking about. They wouldn't have been, he wouldn't have been able to get a job. It would have affected all his relationships. It would have affected everything. And so these guys showing up probably provided enough money for him to not only start his carpentry business, but also to provide for them all the way up until Jesus's ministry began. So it's God supernaturally providing. And they're both Jews, they're both Israelites, but there's a curse on Jeconiah. He's also in the genealogy. And so that's why you have the genealogy in Luke, because the kingly line is broken in Judah. God always has the way of getting around everything supernaturally. So really, we kind of experienced that with other churches. They're like, they want to hear your testimony, but if it's kind of like the Jerry Springer thing again, if it's not juicy enough, or if it's not, I'm just saying, like Nicole and my testimony, fairly boring. We got saved when we were young. You know, a lot of people have grown up in the church. So if you don't come out of something like that, then, you know, they don't really want to hear it. But it's the church especially judges people by the outside appearance. It judged by, you know, we've got tattoos and we've tested multiple churches, and just that will get you shunned at a lot of churches. It's pretty fascinating to test. 2 Corinthians 10. I just read through 2 Corinthians again for the first time. Verse 7. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trust to himself that he is Christ's, let him of himself think this again, that is, that as he is Christ's, even so are we Christ's. It's not our job to determine who's saved and who's not. Mary and Joseph with the Lord in the manger. And then who can God graft in? He grafted us in down here. This is, I got the, they didn't have this exact color, but I put this on my car because we love Alabama so much. But we grafted in down here into this body as well. Jesus talks, judge righteous judgment, judge not on the outside. Everybody always judges on these outside appearances. Who can God graft in? Anyone. God can graft in anyone. Why are you going to limit the Holy One of Israel? I'm not going to share the gospel with them because I don't like the way they look or dress. I don't like the way they talk. I don't know if you all had seen the post that I had shared it with William, that Davida shared about the women that went to, they're all preachers' wives, and they went to a strip club and they were reaching out to these women that's all they've ever known. And they just need somebody to show them some real deal love for once. And that's what we're losing, is the love of Christ. We're all about doing and you know, all this other stuff, all the busyness, without really developing those relationships with people. And that's what God does. Grafts in the people that everybody else thinks is unworthy. We need that scarlet. You want to see another scarlet? It's in Matthew 27. Matthew 27, verse 28. Jesus bore that shame. It just, and they, then the soldiers, 27. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers, and they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. So we find this scarlet thread all throughout anything. It's all about Jesus. It's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. The death, burial, and resurrection is salvation. It is salvation through and through. Yeah. It's been woven. It's a tapestry. That's a tapestry. That's what this, that's, you beat me to my point. Amen. Amen. One other interesting thing, too, is Jesus talking about the bearing fruit, 30, 60, 100-fold fruit. You know what that is? That's a date palm tree. They actually grow. There's three different sizes of date palm trees, and either 30, 60, or 100. So he used these illustrations. And of course, most people don't know that, but palm tree is always righteousness. So we'll go back to what the singular generation. He's the last Adam. There aren't any more kings after him. It isn't necessary to continue on the physical lineage. It goes to us through faith. It's Abraham's spiritual seed through faith. Everything's through faith. It requires obedience, of course, but it's always through faith. So anybody that thinks that they have to clean themselves up or do this or do that before they get saved, it's God rescues people in the midst of their storms, in the midst of the shame and all the chaos. And I mean, we just sometimes we're not exposed to a lot of things, and we hear these stories or see, you know, Jerry Springer, and just amazed that all that kind of stuff can happen, but there's still souls that need Jesus. So please reach out to everyone you come across. Everyone's a soul. All right, that's it. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for your book. Thank you for bringing something amazing out of a, quote, boring genealogy, Lord. It's amazing to see that these are real people with real lives that had real impact on people thousands of years later. And then in the end, we're the benefactors of it because we believe the testimony of your word. And just ask a blessing that we'll see people for souls, Lord, that you died for. Help us to reach everyone. Wake people up and save them before it's too late, Lord. Help us to redeem the time as well. It's never too late to step up and say something about your precious son. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let's stand and sing our last song. I don't know if y'all caught it on the last song that I sang, but I was running out of breath and I choked. I'm like running out of breath a lot these days, so I'm probably going to do that with this song too. Just giving y'all a heads up.
Thank you.
Morning to hear what y'all heard, okay? About all these messed up people. My goodness. Did y'all know all those people were in the Bible? All these messed up people? Amen. I mean, like, wow.
There's only one in the Bible who's not, so.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Whew, I just like, man, a quote that Donna and I saw on our dresser this morning. I'm not doing exactly, but it's like, after all the millions of things I've done to you, Lord, it's still not enough that you would reject me. Man, and you still love me after all that. Whew, goodness. Now, I'm gonna quote Jeremy. This is our quote of the week here. Okay. God grafts in people who the world calls unworthy. Wow. Think about that this week. Think of that. Thank you for the message this morning. Even if, what a messed up message it was. Okay. Wow, appreciate that. Wow, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for a good message. Lord, may we realize that, man, we fall right in line here. Lord, if we think that our life is so messed up, Lord, we gotta look in the Bible and realize the people that you loved are far more weird than what we are. Lord, I just thank you so much for loving us and, man, just taking us and accepting us the way we are. In your name.